Hello everyone, hope you're all doing well. Welcome back to a My Thoughts Don't Matter, episode number 4, and especially with most of you guys being FaZe fans, and despite recent events and FaZe being, of course, number 1 in the world, I thought I would actually reinforce the idea that you have to make money to spend money and relate all of this to the FaZe Clan organization. Now, first, to preface this, My Thoughts Don't Matter, if you guys want to leave a comment down below, I am more interactive on this series, so any comments you guys have, leave them down below, and hopefully I can reply to all of you when you actually do leave those comments. But on top of that, I also want to preface by saying, of course, I have had some mix-ups with some FaZe Clan members in the past. Of course, when CSGO News was first taking off, ever since this plateau happened, actually a large portion of the growth of this channel was through calling out FaZe Clan. I do want to say I'm definitely over that hump. I'm sure they are as well. I have nothing but respect for these owners and what they've done with the organization ever since then, especially their CSGO team. So to get into it and kind of break down the timeline of how you have to actually make money and spend money with this FaZe Clan CSGO team, we're going to take it back all the way to early 2016 and of course go throughout that timeline and actually point out some things that have been insane to see that other organizations simply haven't had the money or the power or the time to actually do. So first off, when you think about the rise of FaZe Clan, you actually go back to when CSGO News almost first started. This is back in early 2016, actually in particular probably January. I started in July, but a few months later was when we actually had FaZe Clan acquire their first CSGO roster, which in itself was one of the biggest buyouts of all time, especially up to that point. It was actually January of 2016 when they bought out the G2 roster. Those were all former Kingwin members, and it was insane to see because the buy-in price was made public of $700,000. Now, within first acquiring this, a lot of people out there, analysts, community members, we all thought, wow, this is insane. A team is actually willing to spend this much money, and of course, I'm sure you guys are all aware the FaZe Clan owners, all several of them, are very well known social media-wise, especially here on YouTube, and they make a lot of money. Therefore, they have plenty of sponsors and their own money, their own backing to actually put into CSGO, and so people thought this is going to be a dominant lineup. If you're willing to spend that much money, of course they're going to expect a lot of that roster, but within three and a half months this roster had done relatively nothing, and it really started to worry a bunch of people. It was actually for 4 straight months these guys weren't just not winning events, they were also not even coming anywhere close, and they were widely known still as the most expensive roster to do very little. And of course 4 months is not a big string of time for teams not to win things, but again, like I said previously, they weren't even coming close to winning anything with this current roster. So that's when we saw their real first changes come in and where this money could actually be spent here in and here out. So it was within that 4 month span that these guys made the tough decision to actually replace a lot of their roster. Now throughout all of this, of course, we've had the FaZe Clan official YouTube page releasing many videos out there using these guys as much as possible in their videos. Of course, people like Mike Lilly, Alu, very well known fan faces in the FaZe Clan team, but they still made the tough decision to actually replace these guys solely based off the success on the CSGO field, which is of course a very tough decision to make. Many teams out there, let's reference like an op like with Hector, you know, trust the process. They'll stick out with players for much longer than they need be. And so, of course, people started to question FaZe Clan as they were getting rid of players after 4 months of no success, which I'm sure you guys are aware of. 4 months with no wins is really not a large gap in CSGO. Many teams out there, actually many teams outside the top 10, will go much longer than 4 months without winning any major tournaments, especially, you know, tournaments that are 250K plus. And so it was actually kind of unique to see a team making changes so abruptly. And the first person to go actually was Mike Lilly. Other members to go, of course, they eventually grabbed in Kerrigan and Alu from Ents as well. Kerrigan, of course, taking over the IGL role, but within a few months, we saw minus Mike Lilly, they actually added in Keo as well. And then famously, many of you guys are aware, Keo was the problem. Although he was doing quite well and the roster was having little success with Keo on the roster, they got rid of him as well. They also eventually brought in AZ, and again, all of these being big money moves, especially not considering the times where these were players that were vastly needed. They were definitely seeking these players out, so probably willing to pay more of a price for them. Now, then eventually we've seen the FaZe Clan roster come to form that we knew this early in 2017, which was still a completely different roster than it is right now. So let's break this down as well. It came in February of this year. We saw some short success, and let's not leave out the fact that late 2016, when they made those first changes, getting rid of Mike Lilly, getting rid of Fox, they had some great changes at the end, great success at the end of 2016. I think it was IEM as well as E-League Season 2, and of course on top of that, we also had ECS Finals. I think it was all third to fourth place finishes. So finishing out 2016 with very few wins, I think maybe one or two at the very, very most, mostly third to fourth place finishes, was still a strong finish, but not enough for these FaZe owners to actually feel like they were confident going forward in 2017 with the same roster, which is again a very bold move to make, paying top price for these players. And again, throughout 2017, we see them make even larger price gaps or even larger price payouts for these big players. So, and of course, the big move they made with February 2017 here, they actually saw some rising success. Again, if you look over the history of this FaZe Clan roster, you see a real progression in terms of, you know, like I said previously, back in early 2016, it was a 4-month gap of literally, it was probably 9th to 12th place finishes, no real 3rd to 4th place and up finishes, and definitely no wins. Then you see the slow progression towards the end of 2016. They have a few of their high finishes, 3rd to 4th place finishes, IEM, Star Ladder, Elite Season 2, so on and so forth. And then 2017 is when their first wins do come as a roster, but it's not enough. So coming February, we actually had the whole situation where AZ did go to North. That North roster, actually previously known as Dignitas, they form over there. They do quite well, so on and so forth. That's a different story for another day. And here's where the problem, like I said earlier, with Kiyoshima, who returned to the roster for a second time, and eventually they considered him the problem, is widely known in the community. Even though he was a solid player, he was eventually replaced, but for one of the biggest buyouts in CSGO history. And then we flash forward on this FaZe timeline, and we really see something that's kind of unprecedented in CSGO. Now, we've seen this in the past where we have high individual payouts, high individual player buyouts for teams who are trying to maybe build a roster around a single player guy. And when I reference this, and of course many of you guys are sure, it's actually Nico from Mouse Sports. They did acquire him for a large amount of money, but it's definitely unprecedented in the terms of how much money they were speculated to have paid for him, because I think in terms of esports, it's very rare to see one player really carry a team so dominantly that they actually can turn around the way they were previously. Now, what I mean by this is, of course, we have many sports out there outside of esports where, yes, you can have one player actually have a large impact on a squad. We've seen this outside of esports and other big sports out there where teams or organizations or clubs will make high individual player buyouts, because we have players like, let's go to a Peyton Manning or a Neymar, who actually make a huge impact on the field. Of course, this is all outside of esports, but when it comes to individual esports, it's hard to see key elements or key real, you know, players out there that actually make a big enough effect where a team can really turn around and have a bunch of average players solely based around one dominant player. You know, we saw this with Mouse Sports. Of course, they had Nico that entire time, and now they have a young player like Rops, but it's not enough to really carry the team. We've seen time and time again, one thing that's probably more important than even skill is actually the chemistry of a team. You can have a bunch of average players, but if you get along very well, you can outperform people above your pay grade, above your skill level. And again, I think it's something that's kind of unidentified so far in CSGO, is can we actually base a team around one dominant player? We've seen it time and time again with people like Simple as well. You just can't. It's not possible to have a dominant one player and actually succeed fully around him in CSGO. Give me a list of people down below you guys think have actually led a team to be very, very successful. I think about maybe a Kenny S or a Scream as well. It's just not enough to have one dominant player. You need to have chemistry and multiple players who are just above that average skill level. Now, on top of that as well, bouncing back to this on topic about FaZe Clan, of course, there was many speculation of how much they actually paid for him. People were saying $400,000, $500,000. I think it was more accurately put around $200,000 for his buyout. We'll never know the true numbers for that, but either way, it was definitely an unprecedented amount. It was a large buyout for Nico, and then they began to actually base the entire roster around him. And here's where I give all my respect to these FaZe Clan owners and organization, whoever it was, whatever management had actually based this move. We saw this throughout 2017. They really kind of incorporated the entire roster around Nico, around Rain, and around Kerrigan, and they found the players these guys most wanted to play with. And these were some big, I almost want to say these were some big nasty buyouts that other teams just simply could not afford to do in such a short amount of time, especially when you go back in this FaZe Clan timeline. The amount of changes they've done in the past year and a half is certainly above average for most teams out there. You know, every 4 months we've seen big changes for this roster, and they have now finally throughout the late 2017 actually seen this roster succeed big time. Now, of course, after they actually had Rain, Nico, and Kerrigan solidified with some other players in that roster, they found themselves the best players to suit their team, acquiring Navi Guardian, and on top of that, I'm sure many of you guys are aware of Olaf Meister from Fnatic, and this roster has slowly become, of course, currently at the point of me recording this, the number one team in the world, and they've had huge events, and we've seen huge dominating events of this FaZe Clan roster. We, of course, had Star Ladder Season 3, even more dominantly was ESL New York. I mean, they lost, what was it, one map the entire tournament. It was just insane to see this team performing on such a level, and they actually did carry it on to E-League Premier, the E-League Season Premier, and on top of that, we also, of course, had this past weekend, IEM Oakland, where they did fall short to NIP in a best of five, but NIP magic is a real thing there. Without that, I mean, it was a rare NIP that we saw, NIP beating teams like SK and Astralis in a best of one. They beat SK in a best of three. It was an NIP that we saw certainly made the most of the maps that were actually chosen, and it was, again, still a second place finish for a FaZe Clan roster who is certainly by far and away the number one team in the world. So hope you guys all enjoyed the video. I just think it's insane to see that a team that has so much power, that is actually, come around. You know, they've really proven the statement, really backed up the statement that it does sometimes take spending money to actually make money. I know back in 2016, I made fun of these guys for how much they spent, $700,000 for a new CSGO roster that actually probably brought in less than $100,000 in prize pool money. That wasn't even including the $700,000 buyout plus all their salaries. They were definitely losing a lot of money, and now it seems they have actually finally, over the term of about a year and a half, actually progressed to have the full lineup that is actually, you know, I was a doubter in the beginning, and now I'm a true believer of the FaZe Clan being the number one team in the world. And it takes a lot of respect from me to actually see an organization take those kind of risks, and they have now progressed to the roster they are right now, and they're all playing on such a high chemistry level, such a high skill level, and we're seeing a FaZe Clan roster and a FaZe team that we have not seen a dominant team like this maybe since 2016 SK Gaming, and I really have high hopes for them in the future. Leave a comment down below what you guys think about this. FaZe Clan backs with a statement, sometimes you gotta spend money to make money. Hope you guys all enjoy. My thoughts surely do not matter, but yours do. Leave a comment down below, and I will see you all next time. Hope you guys all enjoyed. My name is Jake, remember, I like you. Goodbye.